Lord, we beckon on you tonight. You are praising Yahweh.
Concentrate.
Yahweh, this worship is for you.
Alabanta Barosh.
Yahweh, see the lifting of my roof. Holy hands is unto you. You are praising, you are praising Yahweh. Alabana mana mani Yahweh, this worship is for you. Yahweh see, the lifting of my roof.
Now pray in the Holy Ghost. 2 minutes. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Shai ay 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 Samba rabada baleke tererere Rebede bede bele badabas. We chant in the Holy Ghost. Ah, ah, ah. We chant in the Holy Ghost. Ah, ah, ah. Hey, we chant in the Holy Ghost. Ah, ah, ah. Hey, we chant in the Holy Ghost. Ah, ah, ah. Chant in the Holy Ghost. Ah, ah, hey, chant in the Holy Ghost. Ah, ayah, ha, ha. Hey, Baradabas, Abriadabas, we chant in the Holy Ghost. Ah, ah, yeah, we chant in the Holy Ghost. Lelelebosa, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue, edifieth himself. You are speaking mysteries to God. Anamosa brada baba baya da baba mas. Elelelelele baba mas. Abaranda barida mas. Ayaya mas. Oh God, we are set for an encounter. Maya ya 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 ya. Maria da manoso. Erubaska brando balia da mas. Sebe de be de mas. Eka baya na baba ye ya. Ah, pasta bada baya di anamamas. Celebede bede bregede bele de babu sandi. Oh my God. Holy. Holy. Ayata kamash.
Are you Lord God? Almighty. Era mosame.
Ayada basande leke baru sabrani.
What is the left?
You are holy. That's the first dimension of encounter. You must know his holiness.
Are you like? Hey. What is the love?
Maria Bacante. You are holy. Great is your faithfulness, O God Almighty. Are you Lord? What is the love? Thank you, Father. What is the love? Amen, amen. Thank you for your presence in this place. Balamande rasa koromotokos. You are talking about the knowledge of God. There must be a hunger. There is a passion. As it was in the days of David. As the deer panted after the water brooks, so my soul longed out. We want to see your face. We want to know your way. We want to know your way. Higher. The Spirit of God is here. So we can live your day. We want to see your face. We want to know your way. Hey, hey, Jehovah, we want to touch your glory. So we can live your day. My Father, my God, I pray tonight as many that desire an encounter with you. Holy Ghost, you are brooding over every darkness. I gotta be Sante. You are causing light to shine from darkness. You are brood over every darkness. This kind of meeting is not for the faint-hearted. It's for those who want to seek, who want to know, who want to apprehend, who want to become like Jesus. It's not for the lazy. It's not for those that want to be entertained. This is not about entertainment. We speak about an encounter. A God that dwells in eternity, in the midst of an unapproachable light, surrounded by mysteries. We have come to seek him tonight. The dew of his presence is here. The dew of his presence is your. How precious to us is your presence, Yahweh. How precious to us, how precious to us. The knowledge of God is bigger. Please help that lady. Yeah. It's bigger than what traditionally can handle. Yeah. How precious to us. How precious. How precious. Yahweh, 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 hey. Yahweh, my God, thank you for this presence. Holy fire, fall upon many altars. Ha, there are altars that are there. You need to encounter the God of fire from within you. It will put a passion, a hunger, a burden in your spirit. Spirit, you take over. Holy fire, burn upon my altar. God. There are encounters. There are encounters. Holy fire. Burn upon. From within the spirit you take over. Kaladabaladabas. Holy fire. Burn upon me. Hear what the Holy Ghost told me. While I began to pray, the Holy Ghost said to me, there are many hearts that are ready for a genuine transformation. You are tired with entertainment. You are tired of entertainment. Lying to yourself that it is working. You don't know the God of the Bible, but you know Bible. You know memory verse. This is an encounter that will take you from memory verse to intimacy. An encounter where you know that God is alive, that Jesus is real, and that the Holy Ghost is still working today. That's why you are here. You are not here for Jesus. I'm not an entertainer. Please bring that lady here. Bring that lady here. Can you close your eyes and pray? Bring that lady here. Bring that lady. My God, I see the hand of God coming upon more people. Please help that lady. The hand of God is coming upon more people in this place. Father, I ask that dimension. That dimension, Holy Spirit. That's right. Upon more people, Holy Spirit. Encounter. Ayagadabaladas. Rabadabasande la Marian. Jesus, you are here. I'm not a philosopher. We speak about the presence. John said, that which we have seen, we have heard. Our hands have handled this thing. It's not a memory, but it's not about story. It's an encounter. We bring a realm, we present the realm where the Lord has brought us. We bring it to you like a doorway in the spirit where you can enter and see for yourself, and then you return changed. You cannot be the same.
River flow, let eternal river flow in your church once again. Let it not be seen. River flow in this place. River flow. Let eternal river flow in your church once again.
Let eternity be seen. One prayer point. Cry and say, Father, I want to know you more than ever before. Beyond the memory verse, I want to know you. Moses saw you. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I am here tonight. Beyond the memory verse, I want to know you. Elama Shadabaladabakas. Elama Mamamo Sapesh. Rebe Shabaranan Tekabas. Elama Sandele Rebabanenam. Elabakasanta Rabakayas. Rabaseta Bayakas. Amen, amen.
Ebenezer,
my help has come. Every man that encounters God receive help.
Ebenezer.
heaven is up. My help has come.
I heard about out of their bellies are flow rivers.
Mo fe mo mi yo.
Do so la to ri je wa.
Eh. Oh mi yo.
Aka saraba renere mos.
Oh mi yo.
Alele mos amani anans.
Mo fe mo mi yo.
My God, my God, my God.
Do so.
Hey, blessed are those that thirst and hunger after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are those that thirst and hunger after righteousness, and hunger after righteousness, they shall be filled.
Afeli o, afeba osoro, la tori tewa,
alalabalaba shagadabalaba.
Afeli o, afeba osoro. La tori tewa. You are lifted up. You are lifted. You are lifted up. Yahweh.
Ah, my God. Some of you will behold His glory tonight.
You are lifted up. You are lifted up. You are lifted up. Yahweh.
Eyin ni agbega ju. Do we have hungry people here who are not just observing?
Eyin ni agbega ju. Eyin ni agbega ju. Yahweh.
Eya na masanda la barada bakata bas. Eya da bala bayanda rabaso na malama na mayani anas. Salada bala da ba. Eya, eya, eya. Haya da bakas. Ramana manaba de berede kasunda laba. Oh my God.
Oya namasande de de.
Ayanda lada masande dada.
Lord, we enter the holies of holies.
Just class the symbols.
We enter through the blood of the Lamb.
Behold him, behold him, behold him.
We enter to worship you only. We enter,
my God,
to honor you, thy worship.
I want
your name is holy.
Hi, alagada barada brada basanda is holy. Melelele basata la barante omonto beregere bas.
Lord, by your name is holy. Is Lord, and you are glorious, glorious, so glorious in Yahweh. You are glorious, so glorious. In your ways, you are glorious, glorious,
higher,
so glorious.
Higher, 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 higher,
higher, higher,
higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, higher, hig Oh Jesus, Jesus, there is none like you. Oh come, let us adore. Oh come, let us adore him. Oh come, Arakapasabias. Let us sex you, adore. Most blessed, most glorious, creation of thee, Almighty, victorious, thy great name we pray. We magnify you, great one, the eternal I am who sits enthroned above the circles of the earth, and the inhabitants below us but grasshopper before you. Almighty, victorious, thy great. Yanamasande Kambara Namasha. We give you praise. We give you all the glory. That's right. That's right. We worship you. Lord, you are worthy. We give you all, we give you all, we give you all, we give you all, we give you all. We give you all. Help us, please. All the glory. We worship you. We worship you, adore you. Thank you. We give you praise. Sene mere de ventos. Manda as apalanta abanti tabayat. Thank you, Spirit of God. You are El Elyon. You are God Musa. You are Jesus Christ. You're the El Elyon of Israel. You are Elyon, El Elyon. God Most High, God Most High. Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ. Hey. Hello Israel, hello Israel, hello Israel, hello Israel, hello Israel. Father, thank you. Father, thank you. As We celebrate your majesty here. We give you all the praise and the glory. You are awesome. You are awesome. Glory be to God in the highest. Glory be to God in the highest. Let there be silence now. Thank you, Holy Spirit. No man can know God without the help of the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost, we acknowledge your presence here tonight.
Blow, blow, blow like a mighty wind. Spirit of eternity, cover me with your wind. Blow, blow, blow like a mighty wind. Spirit of victory, just cover us with your wind.
Father, thank you. We acknowledge your presence here. We magnify you. Thank you for sending Jesus to us. Honor your word once again. Please, you may be seated. You may be seated. God bless you. Just be seated and concentrate. Be seated and concentrate. Let him play the keyboard. Be seated and concentrate. Glory to Jesus. So glad to be with us this evening. Good evening, everybody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Maybe want to sit down so that you don't obscure the noise station. Good evening, everybody. So glad to be here this evening. I love NLCF. It's been a while I've been here. I think two years now or so. It's been a long time. How are we doing? How are you, sir? God bless you, sir. So glad to be here. Don't get distracted by anything. The topic you have presented is a topic that inspires the Holy Spirit to come. Remember that the first assignment of the Holy Ghost is not to make men fall down. I started teaching. The first assignment of the Holy Spirit is not to make men talk very well. The first assignment of the Holy Spirit is not for you to start a church. No, sir. The first assignment of the Holy Spirit, the most important assignment of the Holy Spirit, is to glorify Jesus. He says he will take of me and show to you. He says he will glorify me. He will not speak of his own self. That's why you can't see him. Because it's about Jesus. The Holy Ghost is successful in your life to the degree at which you know Jesus. And then you can live. You are empowered to live like Jesus. So the Holy Ghost will be successful if we come like this. To seek to know, not the preacher. To seek not to know the history of any man, but to seek to know Jesus. But the beauty of knowing God and the knowledge of God is that from time to eternity, dateless past and dateless future, you cannot conclude and finish the curriculum of knowing God. Dispensation after dispensation, new different dimensions of God. But that was not all there is to God. So he showed his acts to the children of Israel. He showed his ways to Moses. He met Abraham. He gave him a particular name. When he met Moses, he said, I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I want to reveal myself to you in another way. Although some people knew me as Jehovah, I am revealing myself as Yahweh, the self-existing one. And in another generation, he reveals himself in another dimension. He can say, I am Rafi. I am the one who takes away sickness and infirmities from your midst. I am your healer. And then he looks again and then he says, this dispensation, I want to reveal myself to you, not as the healer, but as the God who sees and then supplies. And then they called him Jehovah Jireh. There are many names of God. And that's one of the pointers that bring us into the knowledge of God. But tonight I want to bring an introduction so that we are systematic about the approach. Just open your heart as usual. Like Pastor has said,
The kingdom of God is shrouded with a lot of mysteries. It takes the spirit of wisdom, not the spirit of revelation, but the spirit of wisdom and revelation for you to come into the reality of these things. So that it is not just a memory verse, it is a life. It is something tangible. John introduced Jesus. He says, that which we have heard, that which we have seen, that which our hands have handled, is not something to cram and come and say. You have touched it. And then he said, it is that same thing that we choose to communicate to you. And I know tonight that in the few minutes that we have, your lives, if you will open your heart, something will shift in your spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ. Once again, I appreciate the pastor and all the leadership for the opportunity to be here. Can you maybe reduce this fan a little? Maybe by 1 degree or something. Just make sure prayerfully you listen to what I want to share with you.
River flow, river flow, let eternal river flow in your church once again. Let eternity be.
2 Peter chapter 3, the knowledge of God. I don't know if I have up to 7 sessions. Even if I have 70 sessions, we will just keep going and going and going. And God is mighty. God is mystery. God is deep. God is high. God is wide. But we will touch whatever the Lord has allowed for you guys in this season. The knowledge of God. 2 Peter chapter 3. Give me 17 and 18. Do we love Bible study here? The last time I was around, I remember you people love Bible. Do you love Bible reading? Do you love Bible reading? Do you love Bible study? Alright. Can we read together, please? One to read. Ye therefore. Those which you love totally. Is that the lowest? Was that the lowest? Those which you love totally. Please let them switch it up back there. Can we read together, please? One of the ways to read your Bible is don't rush it. Read it deliberately, meditatively, so that the Holy Ghost can brood on your understanding. This is why many people know Bible, but they don't know the God of the Bible. They just rush everything. No, sir. Let's read it gently. And please participate. Read it out. One, to read. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware. I'm not hearing your voice now. Lest ye also be led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own. Remember that the apostle here, Peter, is not writing to unbelievers, sir. He's writing to brethren. Who are the brethren? The church. He says there is a possibility that if you are not careful, if you are not weary and aware of the things that are happening, if you are not discerning enough, you can be led away. To be led away means to be led out of something that you were before. Because you cannot be led away if you were not led into in the first place. Is that true? Is that true? You cannot depart from a faith that you have not partook of before. So depart means you were once there, but you are no more there. Here it says being led away. How? With the error. So one of the tools of the enemy to lead men away from the knowledge of God is to present error to them. But the challenge is that even error itself can look like truth. You will need a lot of, we will have to receive a lot of help from God to be able to design between the true light that lighted every man and false light, because they are also light. They also sound nice. They sound biblical. Fall from your own steadfastness. Stagger from that position where you are standing in faith in God, then you fall. This is the possibility of Christians falling from steadfastness. Verse 18. Can we read together? I want to hear your voice. This is a small hall, so I should be able to hear your voice. Can we read? One to read. But grow in grace, thank you, and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Notice, the apostle didn't say grow in Greek and Hebrew, which is nice and good and can help you. He said, grow in water.
growing water and in not all kinds of knowledge, but in a particular kind of knowledge, a particular body of knowledge. What does the Bible call it? The knowledge of our Lord and Savior. What is his name? Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Can I hear you say amen? Your knowledge of God affects your earthly sojourn and influences your eternal destiny. If there is any matter that must be treated in every Bible school, it's now to get more members. It is first the knowledge of God. I met a young man who finished from Bible school, and then I was discussing with him about the attributes of God. This attribute of God, how far? The guy said they were not taught anything about the attributes of God in Bible school. Ha! Your knowledge of God affects your earthly sojourn and influences your what? Your eternal destiny. Guess what? Knowledge of God simply means theology. Theos and logos. Knowledge of God means theology. That means your theology affects your life on earth and then your life after it. Now that's a very dangerous word, because that means that how you respond to God will be dependent on what you know about him. And if what you know about him is wrong, you will respond to God wrongly. And if you respond to God wrongly, you will reject him. And if you reject him, you will not reign with him. Your theology matters so much. No wonder God, with all his power, he made sure he looked at the new covenant and was like, having written the Ten Commandments, let me help them with something else. Let them have the Bible. Because if what you know about God is just what was told you by somebody that is not, that does not even know the God of the Bible. Listen, you can know God and you don't know the God of the Bible, because there are many gods. In fact, you can know Bible and not know God. Having said that your knowledge of God affects your earthly existence and your eternal destiny, your knowledge of God, if it is true knowledge of God, it will alter your priorities. Unfortunately, many of the things that we hear today are actually a direct opposite of the reason why Jesus died. Jesus died so that you can die to self and live unto God. But unfortunately, we the preachers are helping to teach men that Jesus died so that you can live for self and abandon God. Because you are now the determinant. You are the one to choose. It's a lie, sir. The knowledge of God. When you live with eternity in view, your values will change. When you know that life on earth is actually a privilege, no, and not a right, a privilege to know God and to worship God. That's why you are alive. Many people are shouting, oh, what's my purpose? My purpose to be a banker. Ogami. The original, the most important purpose of God on for man on earth is to know God and to worship God. The reason, brothers and sisters, why you are on earth first is not to be a banker, is not to be a politician, it's not. Shh. No, sir. The first reason why you are here, the most important reason, is to know God. Somebody say, know God. And to worship God. That means also that your knowledge of God influences your worship. Are we together? Remember John chapter 4, it's verse 24, Jesus speaking. He said that the hour cometh and now is, where the true worshippers shall worship the Father in what, sir? In truth and in spirit. In spirit and in truth. You know what that means? In spirit and in theology. If your knowledge of God is wrong, you cannot worship God appropriately and acceptably. So you can call God all manner of names that is not in his character. Although the tune of the song may be nice, but if it is not theological, if it is not accurate with the person of God, you are not worshiping the God of the Bible. The worship of God is a strict thing. God will not bend the standards because of our ignorance. The goal of God is to grow. Remember the apostle wrote, he said, grow in what, sir? In grace and in the knowledge of the Savior. In the knowledge of a person. No matter what we know, if you don't know God and you don't know him in Christ, you don't know anything. One of the signs that many people don't know God in our day is that we are so subservient to worry and anxiety. Why? Because we are too engrossed and encumbered about the things of this world that we fade away. Things like that are no more in our sermons. Because the things of this world are yet to stay. It's a lie, sir. The Bible says even the world passeth away with a great noise. Everything will dissolve. But God will remain. I said God will remain. When you truly know God, then you will come to realize that death itself is not a termination of life. It's a change of phase. Death is not a termination. It's a transport. It's a transition from one realm to another realm. So that means you'll be careful how you live. Because when you move to the other realm, the reality of that person that looks invisible now but knowable, you will see him there, you will know him. You will be afraid for your life. They will not need to preach a sermon on the fear of God to you. When you behold him, you will fear him. It's unfortunate what we are doing in our generation. Parroting scriptures without living the life. Thinking that we want him. And even our actions reveal that God is nothing to us. So we want to use the Jesus of the Bible for self-aggrandizement. We want to preach the cross in a fanciful way to make the unconverted man interested, and to accept Jesus. It's not about accepting Jesus. It's about submitting to him as Lord. Because he is not just Lord. He is Lord and Savior daily, from eternity to eternity. Even if you don't accept him as Lord, when you get to heaven or judgment room, you will see that. You will find out that he's Lord. You will remember that I told you that he's Lord. He's Lord. It's time to get theological, brethren. Theology is not a hard word. Very simple. It's the knowledge of God. Finding out who God is. I want you to be tired in this conference about religion, lifeless religion. We know all the neglected songs that excite our emotions, but no spirit and life. And so we will live the same way that we went. Then what did we encounter? Who did we go to meet? I don't want a painted toy as a gift. I want content. David cried out. He says, as the deer panted after the water, so does my soul long out. There is a longing. There is a passion. You wake up in the middle of the night, you don't know why. You open your Bible, you are seeking God. You don't have money, you find money, you begin to read. You just want to know God. The purpose of the knowledge of God is not so that you can be a nice preacher. The purpose of the knowledge of God is to know him, to be known by him. Many people know Bible, the God of the Bible doesn't know them. That's why Jesus said, in that day, I'm going to tell them. They will tell me that they casted out devils in my name. And he said, I will tell them, I never knew you. How can Jesus say he doesn't know somebody? Is he not the creator of everything? He said, I will tell them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that walk in iniquity. This is a call to maturity. It is time to seek them. Enough of seeking many other things. You have sought every other thing. Now leave it one side first. Because the thing that we are seeking, even the things that we have now, it cannot remedy for the emptiness that we sense in our heart. That hollow. We just know that we are empty. We are lost without him. We are not satisfied. We want more of him. Cars will not feel it. Money will not feel it. Knowing people will not feel it. Invitation will not feel it. Food will not feel it. Movie will not replace it. Every time a man loses touch with God, he always looks for something to be a substitute. So rather than seek encounter, he will look for entertainment. If he doesn't see entertainment, he will look for, he will find something to read. But nothing can replace the absence of God in a life. Nothing. The knowledge of God affects your earthly existence and your eternal destiny. When the Bible spoke in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 17, when the Bible began to speak about the error of the wicked, the error of the wicked that you see there is when men try to twist scriptures to accommodate lawlessness. The wicked is not just somebody that is fighting people. No, sir. Any man who turns away from the truth, that rejects Jesus, the Bible calls him wicked. The Bible says the error of the wicked, twisting scriptures to support personal ambition. The Bible calls it the error of the wicked. And many unsuspecting people have been carried away by the rising tide of distractions, because they will not, like the Berean Christians, go and find out who God is by themselves. After this meeting, I pray that you will love Bible study like never before. And then you will find out that the Bible is not a textbook to come and use. It's a gateway to introduce you to a life that must be lived. If you claim to believe in Jesus and you are not living the life, you are not a Christian. The Christian life is about growth. And the surest path to growth in the realm of the spirit is not yoga. It's not trying to have out-of-body experience. No, sir. Ex-wife, are you listening to me? Spiritual maturity is not known by out-of-body experience. Did James tell you about out-of-body experience? James, the apostle. Did he tell you he disappeared? Eh? How many disciples disappeared? Who told you that levitating is a sign of spiritual matter? Who taught you all these things? Paul told the guy, he said, oh foolish guy, who has bewitched you? Disappearing and reappearing is never a sign of spiritual maturity. Never. So all the patriarchs in the Old Testament that they did not disappear, they didn't know God. So you must be joking, sir. So David did not know God. A man after my heart, God calls him. He didn't know God. Moses, the meekest man on the face of the earth, he didn't know God, Abby. Out of body. So everybody is looking for out of body experience. You are being deceived, sir. The knowledge that brings growth to you is a knowledge of a person. It's a knowledge of what, sir? A person. You will not grow if you know how to disappear. Babalawo too can disappear. Does that mean he's spiritually mature? Somebody who is totally dead, not alive unto God, you say he's spiritual. Don't be carried away. The knowledge of God is not the ability to sound higher than others. And when I say it, you are like, oh my God, this guy knows God. No, sir. When you want to test, I will teach you maybe on the final session. When you want to test for people who know God, there are seven things. The first is their life. Their words is number five in my list. The first is their life. He didn't say by their speech you shall know them. He said by their life. That's the first place to check. Not disappear and reappear. Not ability to say things that can confuse you. No, sir. Are we together? Oh, you are looking for a romantic sermon about knowledge of God. Is that what you are expecting? I should just tell you, God is just, there are animals with. You better be. So there is a realm when one light will just be bouncing. Bouncing what? Bouncing what? When you talk about light and God, God is light. Simple. In him there's no darkness at all. If you are talking about light and God, God dwells in the midst of an unapproachable light. Go back up. Jesus said, as long as I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. Then he said, okay, you too, you are the light of the world. Which one is bouncing light again? Let's be careful. So that you are not led away. Instead of following a person and walking with a person, you are looking for latest facts. What is the latest thing? They said the latest thing is how to change the clock. Which clock are you changing? The Christian life is about growth. Ephesians chapter 4 from verse 14. Let's begin. The Christian life is about growth. I have my reasons why I give some of you notes, because I know that you need it. Can we read together, please? We'll be reading together tonight. One, two, read. That we henceforth be no more children. You are not reading now. Where are the people that are? One, two, ready, read. That children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait. He says that we no more be children. That means that there was a time we were children. Is that true? Because when you are born again, we call it a new birth. You are born again, you're a baby. First Peter 2 to us, newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow. The Christian life is about growth. Every living thing grows. If you're a Christian and you're not growing, something is terribly wrong. Because you cannot be connected to divine and there is no life flowing in you. Verse 15. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head. Who is the head? Even Christ. Somebody say Christ. I hope you know that one of the signs of babyhood is immaturity. You know, a baby is immature. Anything a baby sees is his own. If he sees it with you, it's his own. If it is near him, it is his own. If you tell him it is sweet, even if it will destroy him, he still wants it. If you tell him don't touch it, he will touch it. Immaturity and selfishness are the signs of babyhood. Selfishness is life revolves around you. You are the only one that the Bible is telling. You know, there is a way we can paint the message of the cross as if you are the most precious being on earth and Jesus just died for you. It's nice, but let me help you. When you look at the cross, the proper way to look at the cross is that your sin was so terrible that you needed so great a savior. You were so terrible in sin that without such a savior, you will die. How did I know? Jesus became, he was made to be sin. He was not a sinner. He was made to be sin. That you might become the righteousness of God. That means you were so useless and so reckless. And on your way to eternal damnation. And God had to send Jesus to die. The cross is not about you. It's about him. Everything God does first is not about you. It's for his glory. That's why when we sing, for your glory, I will do anything. You are reciprocating. Because while you were yet a sinner, somebody died for us. So you love him because he first loved you. That's the balanced Christian life. Not that I'm so priceless. God just came to earth. The anointing does not bring automatic maturity. That you can do like this and people break the chairs does not mean that you are spiritually mature, sir. There is nowhere in the Bible where the Bible says the sign of spiritual maturity is gift. Nowhere in the Bible. The church at Corinth, oh my God, those people, they knew the gifts of the Spirit. They can prophesy. They rattled in tongues like no man's business. Paul said, "Ye are yet carnal. Ye are yet carnal." The anointing is not a sign of spiritual maturity. Giftedness and talentedness is not a sign of spiritual maturity. Every man must journey in Christ. It is a walk and it is work. There are those that say the knowledge of God, Esther, the knowledge of God is work and it's a walk. It's a journey. Christianity is listen to my word. There are many definitions of Christianity. I appreciate it. But let me tell you Bible definition of Christianity. Christianity is an ongoing walk with Jesus. Somebody say ongoing.
Say it again. You not one previous experience. No, sir. On Jesus did not say, come to me and go away. He says, abide. Where, sir? What does it mean to abide? Stay. But you cannot stay if your theology is wrong. Because if the Jesus that was presented to you was a money doubler and a Yahoo Yahoo Jesus, you can't love Jesus. Because in the days of pain like Job, how will you yet praise him? When your knowledge of God is tied to the things that you can get from the Bible. And the only things you now appreciate in the Bible is the promises of God. But the warnings of the scripture, you abandon it. So you want to obey in part? No, sir. You must eat everything. Somebody say eat everything. There are Christians that say they don't believe in the Old Testament. You have stopped reading your Bible. That's why. You have stopped following Jesus. Even Jesus himself said the law and the prophets, they point to me, sir. You say, I don't read Old Testament. I'm only a New Testament. You are joking, sir. You eat, somebody say, eat everything. God is calling us to maturity. Knowledge of God is a call to maturity. Remember, let me give you a little Bible basics. There are two agents of the new birth. When we get born again, there are two agents of the new birth. Number one, right? Two agents of the new birth. Number one, the Holy Spirit. John chapter 3, from verse 3 to 5. The Holy Spirit, when you got born again, you did not go get born again because you felt like getting born again. There are two agents that was at work in seeing that you are born again and born of the Spirit and born from above. John 3, 3 to 5. Can we read together, please? One to read. Jesus. Can we read together, please? One to read. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see. So that means that if you are not born again, you cannot see. No wonder the Bible says, the natural man cannot receive the things of the Spirit, for they are spiritually discerned. It is foolishness unto him. Okay, he said he cannot receive them and cannot know them. For it is foolishness unto him. He said they are spiritually discerned. That means that things of the Spirit can be happening in front of him, but he cannot understand. He lacks the faculty to pick divine operations. He cannot. It's not, no matter how intellectually nice he is, as long as God is concerned, he's dead. He cannot respond. Except a man be born again, he cannot see. So when you are born again, your faculty, a faculty is given to you to see the kingdom of God. The next verse, sir. Nicodemus, he was a religious ruler. He seemed like a man that knew so much. Nicodemus said unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Imagine Nicodemus, a man that was well versed in the Torah and the Talmud, the rabbinical textbook for their etiquette. Yet Nicodemus does not know how a man can be born. He said, how can I be born again when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born again? A old, mature leader, religious leader, does not understand how to know God. But he kept going to the temple, singing and crying, eating of the bread. But he didn't know the bread of life. Jesus was passing by the temple. I'm sure some of them would have told him, keep quiet, you are making noise. Can't you see we are praying and waiting for the Messiah? Even when the Messiah was right before them, they could not see. The next verse. The Holy Spirit is the agent of the new birth. Jesus answered. Let's read now. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again. Be born of. Can I hear your voice louder, please? One to go. Be born and of the Spirit. He cannot enter. So you notice when it comes to the kingdom life, there are two dimensions. There is entry and then there is seeing. The two agents of the new birth are, one, the Holy Spirit. Two, the Word of God. The Holy Ghost is the agent of the new birth. The water here is not talking about water baptism. Because there were many people that were saved without water baptism in scripture. There were people that got filled with the Holy Ghost without water baptism. There were people Jesus forgave without water baptism. There were people Jesus healed without water baptism. Are we together? The water, yes, talking of the ministry of the word, the cleansing power of the word. 1 Peter 1:23. The word as an agent of the new birth. Being born again, not of corruptible seed.
work was already there. Being born again, yes, sir. Can we read now? Not of. By the word of God, which liveth and abideth. How long, sir? So you see that your salvation, there are agents at play. The Holy Spirit and the word of God. Somebody say the Holy Spirit and the word of God. Say it again, please. One more time. Ephesians 5:26. If we talk about the knowledge of God and we don't open the Bible, even if I'm lying to you, you won't know, because I will be sounding convincing. Can we read? One to read. That he might. Look at the word sanctify. The word sanctify means to consecrate. It means to set you apart, away from the world and then unto him. You are set apart from the world unto. You are not set apart from the world to stay there. No, sir. You are removed from and brought into. You are delivered from the power of darkness and then translated into the kingdom of his dear son. So you are sanctified. He said that he might sanctify and cleanse you, it, with the washing of water. By water. What cleanses you, sir? The word. What sanctifies you? The word. What consecrates our hearts to the Lord? The word. Those are the agents of the new birth. I know I'm starting this way. Very elementary. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The word of God is not given to replace God. How many of you have a Bible? Raise up a Bible if you have a Bible. Let me see my Bible. Aha. The Bible is not given as a replacement for God. There are people who love their Bible, but they don't love God. There are people, the Bible to them is a costume. When they are going to church, listen, the Bible is a gateway to present men before God, to present the hearts of men before the theater, the surgical knife of the great physician, to present the mind of God to you, so that you can know, although God is invisible, God is knowable. Although the God of the Bible is invisible, he's knowable. Somebody say God is knowable. You know, you are talking about the knowledge of God. God is invisible. Have you seen God before? But God is knowable. I know him. I don't know everything about him, but I'm knowing him every day. But I know God, sir. He's real. God is alive. He's eternal. Thank you, Holy Spirit. So this is what the Holy Ghost does with the word of God. The Holy Spirit uses the word of God. Are we together? The Holy Spirit does what? Uses the word of God to make us sons of God. That means if you don't pay attention to the word of God, you are not giving the Holy Spirit a tool to work with in your life. When your pastor is talking about Bible reading or reading your Bible, and it's not for a routine, so that when pastor comes and the pastor say, where did you read in your Bible today, sir? Pastor, I read Psalm 91 every day. Psalm 91. They say, where did you read? I read Psalm 23. Then when they say, okay, Sister Jumi, come and lead us in praise and worship. Hey, you just open one Psalm and just say Psalm this one. Oh, praise the Lord, just say, brethren, oh, praise the Lord. In that day of battle, it's not memory verse that will save you. It is the word of God that has rested, has settled in your consciousness, that will produce results in your life. The word of God that has not settled in your consciousness, that you are not conscious of, will never produce in your life. Is memory verse important? Yes, sir. We are still going there. Yes, sir. Don't say you don't need memory verse. You are joking, sir. You need memory verse. In the Old Testament, before men were rulers in the synagogue, they will recite the entire laws of Moses. They will quote Genesis to Deuteronomy. Can you quote Genesis 1 only? And you say they should not be proud. Is it easy? They will recite the entire thing without missing a comma. They were diligent. Even though they were not beholding properly, but they were diligent. No wonder Jesus said, add to your faith, add diligence to it. So that we know how to do. Let's continue. I'm sorry.
the way the Holy Ghost is doing it. So I said the Spirit of God uses the Word of God to make us like the Son of God or the sons of God. And I told you that the Word of God does not replace God in our lives. It only leads us to the heart of God so that we can find out His purposes and then align. Listen, your Bible is a tool of alignment. Your Bible is like a spiritual GPS. It sets the coordinates 20 degrees north, 50 degrees east, and 10 degrees west. It aligns you to heaven. The Bible is not an ordinary textbook, it's a book of alignment. Abalists know this thing. They will carry a book called Account. Is that true? You know what they call Account? Talomo Account, you. Oh, Mina, Account. You don't used to watch Yoruba film. What color of you are watching New Life? All right. Where you, my people, I can't. Have you heard stories that some people will read that thing and they will run mad? Have you read it? Mm-hmm. If an account can make a man run mad, how much more the Word of God that the Bible calls God breathed. God breathed it. Because holy men wrote as they were moved, as they spake, as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. All scripture, the Bible says, 2 Timothy 3:16, is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. It's given by inspiration of God. They did not sit down and feel like writing anything. God breathed upon their understanding, took their intellect from different nations, and they wrote, and their words were in consonance, because it was the same spirit for different men.
Elohim Adonai, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Elohim Adonai, Elohim Adonai, thy kingdom come. Elohim Adonai,
Elohim Adonai, hey, thy kingdom,
oh, oh, oh,
thy will be done.
Elohim Adonai,
Elohim Adonai,
oh, no, no, no,
thy kingdom come,
oh,
thy will be done.
Elohim Adonai,
Elohim
Adonai, in our lives, thy kingdom come,
thy will be done.
Listen, write this down, write this down. My heart really wants to bless you tonight. When it comes to encountering God, write this down. There are two dimensions of divine encounter. And there are two dimensions of the knowledge of God. Write this down. Two dimensions of divine encounter. Number one, the sovereign dimension. When it comes to the sovereign dimension of divine encounter, it is when God Himself comes to seek you. It is when God Himself seeks you, when He searches for you, when He meets you. Is this scriptural? Yes, sir. God in His sovereignty can decide to seek a man. Remember Paul on his way to Damascus, right? A light from heaven, bright light shone upon him. Who appeared to him? Jesus. He said, I am Jesus whom you persecuted. You cannot kick against the pricks. That was a divine encounter. Exodus chapter 3, Moses. Remember Moses? He was on Mount Horeb, tending the flock of his father-in-law Jethro. Is that true? Sovereign dimension of encounter. The Bible says that the bush was burning, but the bush was not burned. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and behold this great sight. Why this bush is not burned? And the Bible says, and when God saw that Moses turned aside, then God began to speak from the bush and said, hey, stay where you are. Take off your sandals, for where you stand is a holy ground. Sovereign dimension of encounter. The second dimension of divine encounter is deliberate pursuit of God. At that time God has sought you, is now your time to seek Him. Moses, Exodus chapter 33, verse 18. Moses said, show me your glory. God first visited him, Exodus chapter 3, but he now said, no sir, I want more. Because the proof that you truly know God is that you want more. You are never satisfied. It's a holy form of covetousness. You are never satisfied. You want more. You want to know Him so that you can be like Him. Deliberate. Psalm 42. As the deer pants, David,
after the water. My soul longs. It's a deliberate longing. You are seeking him. You want to know who he is. Does God approve it? Yes, sir. Jeremiah 29, verse 13. If you seek me with the whole of your heart, you will find me. Why are people not finding God again? They are not seeking him with the whole of their heart. They are seeking him for self. They are seeking him for things. For what he can offer them. Like a Father Christmas. They are not seeking him because they want to know him. But we have gathered here tonight because we want to know him.
We look to Yahweh. Yahweh. Our hope is Yahweh. Yahweh. We look to Yahweh. Yahweh. Forever Yahweh. Yahweh.
Two dimensions of the knowledge of God. Number one, theoretical slash intellectual knowledge of God. Matthew 22 verse 37. You don't only seek God with your body. Matthew 22, 37. Can we read together, please? One to read. Jesus. Please, who said it? Who said it? Can you shout? I can't hear you well. That's how to respond. Jesus said unto him, what did Jesus say? Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. That's one. Two. All thy soul. Three. So you see that in Christianity, when you accept Christ or you submit to the Lordship of Christ, you don't keep your brain outside of the church premises. God does not uninstall your brain that you can't use it in Christianity. There are people who say, no, your brain. No, sir. You that's why he gave you a brain. The last word here is all thy what, sir? Mind. Somebody say mind. What is mind? Your cognitive ability. There are many religions today that once you accept their God, you can't think for yourself. They will tell you it is only what the Alpha said that you should believe. In the Alpha hearing is the only one hearing God. But the God of the Bible, the beauty about the God of the Bible is that every man can know him. He's not exclusive to one man. Every man can know him. The Bible says he revealed his ways to Moses and his acts unto the children of Israel. It is not his fault when he met them at Mount Sinai and there was a quake and there was fire and there was smoke and there was tempest. The men of Israel were afraid. They said, go, Moses, only you go and meet God. We don't want God. But the God that we present today is a God that is fluffy like a puppy. So sweet and nice. It's not God. The God that you can control is not worthy to be a God. You know how bandits can control their own idols and tell them what to do. Not the God of the Bible. The intellectual dimension. 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 15, I guess. The intellectual dimension of the knowledge of God. Can we read together, please? One to read. But sanctify the Lord God in your heart and be what, sir? Look at me. Your evangelism is useless if you don't pay attention to finding out who the God that you want to represent is. There are many of us, you have never used your money to buy a Bible. What kind of a Christian are you? Your walk with God has not cost you anything monetary, and then you are claiming that you are a Christian and that you don't know God, sir. Go and find out people who truly know God. They want to know him. They spend their lives. They give their money. They give their time. They buy resources. I see some of you come to church. No Bible. No notebook. Maybe your pastor has not told you. Ask him when he was in 100 level. You remember when you were in 100 level? How many years have you known me now? Like 4 years. Then he used to play keyboard for me. If he did like you, he will not be like this.
I was listening to him when he was leading us to prayer. I said, he's like, this guy is still working with Jesus. You don't read your Bibles. And you have your, you come to the house of God. No Bible. What if there is no projector? And I'm speaking convincingly and I'm lying to you. How will you know? You say you have the Holy Ghost. You don't know the Holy Ghost. One of the most important signs that you know the Holy Ghost is that you are meek enough, you want to learn. The Holy Ghost is naturally attracted to meek people. James chapter 1 verse 21. Lay aside all filthiness and superfluity of nothingness. Receive with meekness. Meekness, the engrafted word which is able to save your soul. Don't go there. Go back to our scripture. It's able to save your souls. You come to the house of God. You keep subscribing data every day. Data and datum every day. You are busy checking the statuses of men. But the scripture that reveals the status of God to you, you don't have time for it. You are too busy for the Holy Ghost. And you are wondering why God is not using you. You have to repent. Buy study Bibles. They say it's 12,000 also. Save and buy it. When we were on campus, there were times I would trek from here to Christ Store in town. I may have no exit. Exit. You know exit? Is it far or is it close? Is it far? On foot, I would trek there because I wanted to read a book. I didn't have money to go to town. I would trek to town. And then I will beg those walking there. Oga Marcus, please, I need money to go back home. I trek there and he will give me 15 naira then. Is it 15 or 13 naira then, sir? And I will come back to campus. I will sit down. Or at Robert's, expect a miracle. I will read 164 pages on one sitting. And then I will close it and come back to campus. I was seeking God. They will buy spiritual book for you. I've still been begging you to read it. You don't want to know God, sir. Common concordance of 2:5. You will not buy. There's no money. There's no money. But when you go to the bank to collect your statement of account, you will be surprised how rich you are. But you have spent that money on vanity. And then you are wondering why they are lying to you and you don't know that they are lying to you. It's because you have not invested. The Bible says if you sow to the spirit, he said if you sow to the flesh, you will of the flesh reap corruption, decay and emptiness. But if you sow to the spirit, you will of the spirit reap life eternal. What you invest in is what you will harvest. Your life grows in the tangent, in the direction of your commitment. Anything you commit to is what you become. What are you committed to? That's what you are becoming. You cannot behold Jesus and become something else. It's not possible, sir. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 18. But we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of God, we are changed into the same thing that we behold. Who have you been beholding? What are you beholding? That's what you are becoming. Nothing more, nothing less. Number two dimension. So I spoke about the theoretical knowledge of God. Able to give, 1 Peter 3, it's in that scripture. It says so that you will be able to give an answer for the hope that you are, the reason why you believe in Jesus. So I ask you, why do you, you came to preach to me and you just say, hey, brothers and sisters, I used to see them when I'm traveling, disciples. You say, good morning, brothers and sisters, let us pray. And then they pray and then they say, ha! Hey, if you wear earring, you will go to hell. If you wear trouser, you will go to hell. If you wear a chain, you will go to hell. If you laugh too much, you will go to hell. If you this, you will go to hell. Oh yeah, if you want to repent and accept Jesus, that's not the gospel. The gospel is not, that's not the gospel, sir. Is that what Jesus preached? Is that what John preached? Is that what the apostle preached? Is that what the prophet preached? The prophet preached repent. John the Baptist preached repent. Jesus preached repent. But the kingdom of God is at hand. Which gospel are you preaching that is not talking about Jesus Christ? Which gospel is that? What kind of gospel is that one? You even write a calendar and draw a calendar and say everything that will take you to a kingdom. Kingdom. No, sir. No, let's not take these things out of context. Kingdom. Maybe Zobo said, who knows? You are Zobo. So some of you that like Zobo, now you are going to hell. And some will say they went to hell. They went to heaven and hell. And it's only their pastor that they saw there. Guess what? That pastor is still alive. The pastor that they saw in heaven is still alive. And he can choose to not follow Jesus again. I hope you know. But they saw him. Only them and their pastor. Just say you ate too much. And there were too many activities in the day. The Bible says too many activities to bring dream. Too many activities. Ecclesiastes used to bring. One wrote a Christian book.
same book, and then he said Buddha and Muhammad, they are sitting down with Jesus in heaven. The day I read, I said, what are we, what's wrong with us? Are we all right? People are not serious anymore. Is that the gospel? So people don't know how to give reason for why they believe what they believe about Jesus. And then so you walk up to me and say, bro, the way you are looking, you are dressing well, but are you saved? Are you saved? And then you are mentioning the names of people and say, that pastor, that one is not, I didn't see that one in the name, I saw him in there. Listen, you and your pastor are not the marking scheme of God. Jesus Christ is the only yardstick through which men will enter eternity with God. Only Jesus, not your pastor. Your pastor is not the template for the Christian life. It's Christ. It's Christ. It's not your source. It's Christ. It's Christ. So I'm like, okay, show me in the entire scriptures, because I'm a good Bible student. Show me in the entire scripture from Old Testament and New Testament the people who saw other people already in heaven and those people are still on earth. Show me too. If you can show me, show me. You are saying they saw Moses. Moses, did you see his body on earth? Is it, was he still on earth when they saw him at the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus? Was Elijah still on earth physically? How come you the ones you saw, they're already in heaven?
River flow, let eternal river flow in your church once again.
So when they ask you, can you give an answer to every man that asks you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear? Not with arrogance, with meekness and fear. That's a branch of theology called apologetics. It's a branch of theology. Men like R.C. Sproul, Ravi Zacharias, Nabil Qureshi of Blessed Memories, and other great men like that that do apologetics. They don't do signs and wonders actually, but they do more of teachings, all right? They try to bring logical conclusions to issues about, okay, why did Jesus die? How did he rise again? Did he really rise? You know, things like that, just to help your conviction, all right? Yes, it's called apologetics. Can you give a reason why you believe what you believe? Convincing reason. And then I ask you, why do you believe in Jesus? And I say, my father is a pastor. In our house, all of us are born Christian. Why do you believe in Jesus? Have you ever thought about it? Why do I believe in Jesus? The pastor scared me, then I ran from front. No, sir. Why do you believe in Jesus? Have you thought about it? Because when you believe right, then you can live right. If you don't believe right, even if you are trying to please God, it's a work of the flesh. It will not bring glory and honor to God. Number two dimension of the knowledge of God. The experiential dimension. Experiential / revelation knowledge of God. Experiential / revelation knowledge of God. It was Saint Augustine of Hippo. Saint Augustine was an ancient saint. He was the one that said, God is invisible. He cannot be seen with the eyes, but he can be seen with the heart. God is real to me, brothers and sisters. You may not be able to see him with your eyes, but you can see him with your heart. You can see him, you can know him. Now, one of the dangers of just having a theoretical knowledge about the God of the Bible is that arrogance begins to set in. That's why in the book of Romans chapter 1, they say, even though they knew him as God, the Bible says they knew him as God, yet they did not honor him as God. The Bible says, okay, for that reason, God gave them over to a reprobate mind and left them to do the things that are terrible, that are unacceptable, that are immoral. The creeds of Christianity are nice. Quoting and memorizing things are nice. But the proof of the true Christian life is in conduct and character. If it is not showing in your life, you don't know it yet. 1 John chapter 5, I think verse 30 or so. He said this is the eternal life. Acts chapter 17 verse 30 or so. This is the eternal life, that they know you and your only true son, Jesus Christ. It is the knowledge of Christ that is eternal life. You say everybody has eternal life. No, sir. This is eternal life, that they might know you, your only true son, Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the life. Whosoever knows the son and has the son has life. If he doesn't know the son and doesn't have the son, he does not have life. Experiential knowledge of God. Powerful. This one has to do with your heart. It's a heart operation. Sometimes you cannot explain why you know what you know, but you are sure that I know him. I know my Redeemer. You can't even explain it. And I know my Redeemer. Many years ago, I wrote a book on the knowledge of God. I started with the testimony of creation, how that the heavens declare the glory of the Lord, and the earth show forth his, the firmament show forth his handiworks. Day unto day uttereth speech. Look at nature itself, and then you say nobody made it. Will you be sincere? Do you have conscience at all? And then you said everything came out from a cataclysmic explosion. No, sir. Or a Big Bang theory, that there was something that caused it. Listen, if Big Bang theory is correct, that something caused it, guess what? God is the first cause that caused everything to begin. So it is still God. God is the uncaused cause. That's why it's called Yahweh. Eternal. Self-existent. It was not created by anybody and cannot be destroyed by anybody. That's why it's not subject to time. Eternity itself lives inside God. Is that I am that I am. A heart knowledge, a revelation knowledge. The reason why I started with the theoretical knowledge is because if you are not guided by the scriptures, it is possible for you to claim that you had an encounter with God, just like that one that says, oh, Muhammad and Buddha and everything. And then maybe that day you just meander. Something happened in the realm of the spirit, and then of course your spirit, something happened to it. Only for you to enter a wrong pathway in the spirit, and then you are seeking, then you are beginning to read the seven books of Moses and the books of Enoch and the forbidden scrolls in a bid to prove that you have arrived, to add to your ministerial CGPA. You will meet the devil at the end of that journey, and then you will realize that all your pursuit has been an effort into futility, because the only rewarding pursuit is the pursuit of God, not the pursuit of knowledge to prove to men that you have arrived. Where have you arrived? In God, you don't arrive, you continue. You don't arrive, sir. The day you think that you have arrived is a sign that you are backslidden. It's a sign that God has left you. It's a sign that you need to repent and get back into alignment quickly. The God of the Bible is the only true God. And you must be guided by the pages of the scripture. Why? Because if that encounter comes and you are not mature, you have not decided to learn the basics of the scripture and to live by it. When an encounter comes, that encounter can even destroy you. It can be from God and still destroy you. Because what will happen? One of the things that will happen to you is that you will have zeal without knowledge. I remember when we were on campus back then. Thank God for a genuine meek heart. It's hard to be meek. Listen, then my hunger for God was so mad. It's still mad though. You don't want to live with me. My hunger for God is terrible. It's contagious. It's like a virus. You'll be infected like Kata. You'll be infected. Even you won't know why you are reading your Bible again. You won't know. Something else. It's an installation. You come into that atmosphere. When you go back home, you'll be wondering, but why am I? You are tired of the status quo. There's gotta be more than this. There's gotta be more, gotta be more. There's gotta be more than this. Listen. We will do 7 hours with God in MFM back then. 7 hours with God, program. After 7 hours with God, as they are driving them to Iworoko, I'm following them in the bus. And then I will climb Iworoko mountain around 4 a.m. Very early in the morning, or 3 a.m. or I can't even remember, midnight. I'll carry my torchlight and my Bible. I will look for one corner again.
I'm reading my Bible. I was not preaching then. Nobody knew. I'm reading. I'm searching the scriptures. Ah, Jesus, I want to still know you. Ah, this scripture I found. Ah, this Bible. I'm checking. I'm seeking God. It's like cold. There were days God will tell me, go to that mountain. I will go and stand there. And he will tell me rain will fall. And that allow the rain to meet you there. Everybody on the mountain will run down. Then they have not built that church that they have there now. I will stay there. The rain will beat me. It's not as if the Bible will be immune to the rain. The rain will beat the Bible. Then the word will come from the scriptures. But I will hold on to that word. If your knowledge of the scripture is not leading to obedience, you are reading another thing, not the Bible. The purpose of the knowledge of God is to worship him, is to live for him, is to obey him. If your knowledge of Bible is not leading to obedience, you don't know Bible, sir. You may know memory, it's not Bible. Check your life. Is there obedience? Can men look at you and say, there's obedience, there's submission? Eternally, you are beautiful. Eternally, you are glorious. Eternally, eternally, you are God. Eternally, you are beautiful. Eternally, you are glorious. Eternally, eternally, you are God. Let me show you a scripture as we prepare to pray for tonight. Holy Spirit, Acts chapter 17. Let me start with this. Acts chapter 16 from verse 16. Let me show you something. Let me just summarize it. There was a damsel in the days of the apostles who brought much gain to her masters because she was possessed with the spirit of divination. Every man is possessed with a spirit, either the Holy Spirit or another spirit, but a spirit possesses every man. Men don't just act, something controls them. It's like a chessboard in the realm of the spirit, determining the life and destinies of men. And it came to pass as they went to prayer. You say you know God and you don't like prayer. You don't know him. You didn't read the life and times of Jesus. How that he will go to a solitary, he will forget about sleep, go to a solitary place to pray. Some say, but if God knows all our thoughts, why are we praying? Prayer is a sign that you are humble. Prayer is a sign that you acknowledge God. Prayer is a sign that you know God and you still want to know him. Prayer. They went to prayer. A certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination. Notice the Bible did not say the spirit. It said a spirit of divination. He met them. She met them. Which brought her masters what now? Say it loud. Say it loud. You see that Christianity. Look at me. Look at me. That Christianity that says that everything about God is about much gain. And when I mean gain, I mean the ephemeral canal things that will not perish. And he said that's what Jesus died for. Just the much earthly gain. Am I saying earthly gain is bad and that you should not have money? No, it's good. But I'm saying that's not the emphasis of scripture, sir. Matthew 6:33. Seek first the water. And his water. And all these things shall be water. When you misplace priority and you carry what to be added, you now begin to major on the minor and minor on the major. You have been deceived. You cannot end where the former sins ended. It's not possible. When your direction is wrong, your destination is automatically wrong. Are we together? A certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination methods brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. There are many people today, pastor. They come around on campus and they go to different churches and they hold different programs. What they are doing is soothsaying. You know what the meaning of suit? How many of you have used lantern yet to read? You know that thing that used to be up, that black suit? They call it suit. Suit is not suit like suit. Suit is so soft, it's not harmful. No, that means if it was a medicine, it cannot cure you. If it was a poison, it cannot kill you. It's very impotent. It cannot bring life. So barren. Soothsaying. Sweet talk. Flattery on the altars. Exciting your emotions, but drawing you away from Calvary.
We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We shall not be moved.
Let me teach you that song. That's the song.
We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We shall not be moved. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We shall not be moved. Our Calvary. Our Calvary. Our Calvary. Our Calvary. Awo ni shubu. Awa wo kavari. Awa wo kavari.
Arabako sata. Arabasande rekete basha.
Awa wo. Awa wo kavari. Awo ni shubu. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary.
Rabada bale.
We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We shall not.
Even though you don't have money today, look to Calvary.
We look to Calvary.
Money does not define your life. A man's life, he does not consist in the abundance of the things that he has, but that he knows God. Let him glory in the fact that he knows God.
Ah, we look to Calvary. We look to Calvary.
We look to
Calvary.
We shall not. Can you lift your hands?
Say, I look to Calvary.
of God.
Ah.
How can you know God without Christ?
We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary.
We look to
Calvary. We look to Calvary. We look to Calvary.
He
was crucified, lay behind a stone, running to die, so that you can live. Rejected and the Lord, rejected and the Lord. He was trampled on the ground.
Yeah. Ah.